Hello, welcome to Q&A Live. I'm your host, Stephen Drunsic, and today we've got two very special guests with us, two individuals who have been fixtures in our community for many decades. You may have done some business with them, you may have come across them at the Spiral Press Cafe having a coffee, or you may have seen them at a local fundraiser, but I'm fortunate enough to have today joining with me Jim Comar.
How are you doing, Jim?
Hey, Mike.
And Mike Powers.
Hey, Stephen.
Thanks for joining me.
Yeah.
I understand this is both your first time being on cable access here.
Yes.
And, I'm fortunate to have you both here. You know, one of the reasons I wanted to bring you on, partly an impetus of my mother, Linda Drunsic, talks very fondly about you and always says you guys always have great stories to tell about this town because you've been raised here, you were educated here, you've been friends for a long time. And I thought, you know, because this town seems to be going through another transition period, there's a lot of activity, some of it, I think a lot of people are questioning what direction this town is going in. It might be nice to reminisce a little bit and talk about the days of yore, you know,
yeah.
the heady days, what it was like living in Manchester in the 60s. I know you both went to Burn Burton, my alma mater as well, albeit probably about a decade apart. So I just thought I'd open up the floor and maybe get some background on both of you. And I mean, Mike, maybe you want to start.
Well, I guess I can start because I'm the oldest. but I've known Jim since Jim was born,
That's right. Practically, and his family. For sure.
And in those days, those early days of Manchester, particularly the 40s and 50s, there were not as many people in town, and people tended to know one another by street and by district and by school. All the parents were friends who grew up together, by and large. Totally different kind of atmosphere than we have currently. And, you know, our lives were... We're very, very reduced to what went on in Manchester. We belonged to the local Grange, for instance.
Yep.
Boy Scouts was a huge thing as I grew up, very big in my life.
The Grange Hall being right next
to the same place.
Yep. Okay. That was a busy place when we were
kids. And the most boring meetings in the whole world, but you went anyways because they had orange drink afterwards from Wilcox.
Yeah. So That's right.
Maybe some ice cream. So, you know,
that was the big pull back then.
Yeah, that was the place to go. That's where we had Cub Scout meetings and banquets and things like that.
And the band was another huge thing in Manchester.
You're painting a very Norman Rockwell-esque picture, which
sounds like
accurately captures what Manchester was like back then.
It definitely was.
It certainly was. And frankly, practically everybody was on the same economic plane. So that, you know, there was not much of a division in town. There were the summer folks who you tended not to know, and then there were the rest of us.
That's right.
Who lived here and went to the schools and belonged to the local organizations. Little League, as I said, Scouts was huge. The Manchester Band was very big at the time.
I played the Manchester Band.
I did. I played the trumpet and the tuba.
I played the saxophone. It was great. For as long as
marching
the band stayed
and
play.
Everything,
Right. The band ended when I was in high school.
Well, we don't have marching bands.
No, not much anymore.
Too bad, too, because it was fun. We used to go to Burlington to the All-State Parade and
it was way out of town.
And stuff. It was fun,
And on Memorial Day, we went to four towns, Londonderry, South Londonderry, and Dorset, and East Dorset, and Manchester, and marched in each one of those towns, you know, in a little parade, and usually got sick to my stomach from eating too many hot dogs and got home.
Well, you know, it's both of you, like, you went away, you went to St. Joseph's.
Yes.
And then you went to Franklin Marshall.
I did.
You were about to go off to Syracuse, correct?
That was my plan.
Then you came back here and you got into selling insurance at the family business.
I went to work the summer before I was supposed to go to Syracuse with my uncle in my grandfather's firm, my grandfather and grandmother's firm, and I got married. And then along came Craig Powers, and I decided that I needed to take a year before I went to Syracuse, and 50 years later, I'm still here. I never made it to Syracuse.
That's right.
And
I went to St. Joe's Business College, and of course I worked at the quality restaurant all the way through high school, you know, working for my folks. The spring of my first year, as that first year ended, I was in the quality one day having lunch, sitting at the family table there, and Homer Ellis was there too. You know, it's where all the local business guys gathered and had their lunch and, you know, had some dialogue, and it was just fun to know everybody. And while we were sitting there, Homer said to me, "What are you doing this summer, Jim?" And I said, "Well, I guess I'm working here. You know, that's kind of the plan." And he goes, "How would you like to work at the bank?" And I went, "Well, okay, you know, what would I do there?" And he says, "Well, we need somebody to go to the post office and, you know, do all that kind of stuff." And I said, "I'll do it." So Dad wasn't totally happy with me because I wasn't going to work for him.
Because you got your family owned the quality.
Yes, okay. Right. So and he was sort of counting on me to be some of the summer staff. But I did go to work at the bank, and I was the errand boy.
But the bank was right next door.
Right next door.
You were the gopher.
I was the gopher. You know, the post office was down. We called it down by the bridge. You know, I went
where
down
coaches.
There. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
I was trying to figure out. All right.
Yep.
I got you there.
And I'd go there a couple times a day and take the mail and bring the mail back. And one of my biggest duties that I've always laughed about this, there was only like 20 people working at the bank at the time. And I'd have to go around the whole bank at like 10 o'clock and make a list of who wanted what from the quality restaurant. So I'd go there and get everybody's coffee and muffins and all that kind of stuff.
But look at all the business you brought to the quality.
Right, that's right. And 5 days a week I was in
there.
Well,
Jim is being modest. The quality was the center of the universe.
It was the watering
hole, right?
Yeah.
Basketball games.
Oh
yeah, yeah.
Orange freezes.
It was the center.
Lemonade, if you were sophisticated.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm telling you. Well, that was orange drink. That wasn't as good as an orange freeze.
That's right.
Okay. Orange freeze was carbonated.
Okay.
Yeah. But we all went in there. Comar would meet us there and tell us to be good. And generally we were, I think.
I think so. Yeah. I think she liked that as much as you.
We loved the place. That was Mrs. Comar was his grandmother, who was just an icon of Manchester.
Well, how long was it the quality?
Well, my family owned it for 55 years. They opened 1920 and closed in sold it in 1975. And Larry and Penny Terrell bought it.
I guess some of your family members are probably iconic at this stage because they've been preserved forever in some of Rockwell's.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, my grandfather.
Grandfather in particular, the famous painting.
Yeah,
Is that the telephone?
No, that's
that's called Gossip.
Gossip.
Oh, Gossip.
And my grandmother's
okay.
in that one.
All right.
And my grandfather's in the one called War News, and the original painting hung in the quality until they sold the restaurant.
Yeah.
And I've got a really nice reproduction of it, but the original's in the part of the permanent collection at the Corner House Museum in Stockbridge.
I've seen it just recently.
Have you really? Yeah.
And of course, you go down there and you see that, and it brings back a flood of memories.
Yeah.
Mr. Comar, Jack Lake, I think, was in that picture. And it was always hanging there. It was part of our lives.
So yes, it was, yeah.
So it sounded like town was, you know, it's a tighter community. You talk about how, you know, they were the summer people, but most everyone knew everyone.
Yes, definitely.
Obviously, this is before we had the retail outlets, before we ever had any flashing lights of any sort.
We had the ski industry. Was the first
when,
big
when did the ski industry start taking
40s.
Off?
40s.
In the
40s. Okay. 45.
But Stratton didn't start until
that
the
didn't
50s,
start until
60s?
I was in college. Okay. 62, maybe?
Yeah, that's about right, probably.
I remember Landy Bartlett, my friend, taking me over there. We had to go by way of Taylor Hill. There was no main road.
Okay.
And I just looked at it, and I was just overwhelmed. I said, they're building this in Vermont?
Yeah. An Austrian ski village.
Yeah, with bears.
And then the Austrians descended into the...
With the accordions.
Right, sure.
Yep. You know, I was in high school in the 60s, and I worked at the restaurant, at the quality restaurant, and Manchester was the go-to place for the skiers. There wasn't anything really going on up on the mountain, so on Friday night, the town started to fill up, and at
you got to paint a picture for Friday night here.
It's
really
unbelievable.
I mean, what are we talking? Five Flies or
Before that, there was the Knot Hole,
okay,
which is in the North Shore Bookstore.
That's
that was
right.
A beautiful little bar in the North Shore Bookstore, and then the dining room of the Coburn House was the main go-to place to eat, other than the quality.
The Coburn House.
It was called the Coburn House.
Okay.
Yeah. Tony Perry's mother owned it. Yep. Tony Perry started the sirloin or the Five Flies.
But all the folks that would come up, what, from the city, I presume?
Yeah. Or?
Some of them came on the
buses.
Train. Believe, at one point, they were coming on the train, weren't they?
Yeah, and in buses after that.
And and you know what would happen? They'd get here, and we had a standing line at the Quality Restaurant every Friday and Saturday night. They'd be out.
Out the door.
I don't know. The main entrance, we used to lock the door in the main entrance to the restaurant, and they'd come in the hallway and start forming a line into the restaurant. But they
you
were
probably
down
had regulars you probably knew.
Oh,
I know the owner.
Oh,
right?
Yeah, definitely, yeah. But the line went all down the sidewalk in front of the bank building. And that went on.
And Sunday dinners, the same thing in the summer.
So we'd be like, oh, my God. We'd go out every once in a while to see where the line was. Because literally, and that's every Friday and Saturday night. And there were people, regulars, that came up from the city every weekend. And I can name some of them, actually.
Yeah,
we got to be. There was a couple. Their name was Henry and Rita Paquette, as an example of that. And they lived down in Chicopee, Massachusetts. And we got to know them, and my brothers actually went down there and spent a weekend with them one time. They were just customers, but you got to know people like they were your old friends.
Sure.
So
well, let me tell
cool.
you how great it was. The bus to New York City used to stop in front of the Coburn House so people could get off and then get on to go to New York. So they'd go in the Coburn House on Sunday afternoon when we had blue laws and you couldn't get a drink without a full course dinner.
Yeah.
They'd arrive at 1 o'clock, order dinner, and say, hold it. And they'd sit there. I worked at the Coburn House. I observed this.
Okay.
So I was a busboy. So they would sit there and drink for 2 hours. Then they'd say, bring the dinner. You bring the dinner in, about 4:30, the bus would pull up, and they'd all stumble out out of the Coburn House into the bus and head for New York City.
Sleep all the way to the city.
But if they took the bus up here, how do they get around up to the mountains and such?
Well, a lot of times there was transportation provided by the mountains or a cab.
There were taxis. We had taxi service here.
Wow.
NOLAs.
I guess before the advent of everyone having their own automobile.
That's right. When I was a kid, my parents shared a car with my grandparents. Not everybody had a car. Now everybody, the parents have it, and every kid has one and whatnot. But people didn't, there weren't several cars in a family back then.
I worked at the Village Country Inn, which was then Ye Olde Worthy Inn.
Sure.
Ye Worthy Inn.
Yeah.
And they had ski clubs come in their own buses. And you'd be there Friday night at 5 o'clock, and these buses would start rolling in. These people had been partying all the way up from New York City.
That's right, yeah.
They'd roll in, they were all hooking up with one another, have dinner, have a riotous time, and then they would go to the mountain early in the morning in their own buses, plus the Worthy Inn had its own shuttle.
Okay.
At a little bit before then, that they would take to Snow Valley, which was another ski area. And I'll tell you, as a young boy from Manchester, you're pretty sheltered, but when you're a bus boy and you're seeing all these New Yorkers arrive and watching them, you're thinking, there's more to life than Manchester. Wow.
Right.
Yeah, definitely. We thought it was action-packed when it really wasn't. The community was
wonderful.
Very seasonal back then, though. There were definitely defined times during the year where we sort of got our town back a little bit.
Yeah,
that's
what
we used to say, because after foliage, things would really get quiet here.
And the mountain didn't open then until
because
mid-December.
There wasn't that second
December.
Homeowner population
wasn't
that was established.
There wasn't, there wasn't. And there wasn't all the shopping and stuff that there is now. And particularly in the wintertime, some of the businesses closed. So during the ski season, things were great here. But then when the mountain closed, we had that, well, we always called it mud season, where there wasn't really much going on. That Dad used to close the restaurant for a week or two and do maintenance stuff, clean, you just shut down because it wasn't worth opening the door, kind of.
And in the fall, the whole town went deer hunting.
Yes, that's right.
You
that's
couldn't get your.
That's still kind of.
You couldn't get any
you
plumbing.
You had to worry
done.
About shooting your neighbor.
Yeah,
that was in the same time.
You couldn't get anything done, and the mountains never opened until mid-December at the earliest, usually Christmas or after.
Yeah, because snowmaking wasn't.
No, and so there was this lapse
didn't
after
happen.
Fall.
Right.
The same thing would happen.
Right.
We'd have this month and a half, and the only thing that went on was deer hunting.
Right.
Yeah, or Grange Hall suppers.
There
Grange Hall
you
suppers.
Go. Church dinners.
The church, yeah,
that's
right.
That was a big deal.
Yeah, but the Grange Hall, really, when you think back on that, really was sort of a place where things were happening. They had wedding receptions there, and you know, it was just, life was simpler back then. They didn't have
life was simpler, and then what happened? What was it? That first, I know in the early 70s there was a little bit of a real estate boom.
The town ran down. A lot of buildings were in bad condition. Some of them were vacant. A lot of businesses were not doing well.
Right.
Particularly on Depot Street, which we call the Flat Road. You know, that's the road that's Route 30. Mm-hmm. That area was derelict. And some of the buildings in the center were a little derelict.
And, of course, and up in the village as well.
And in the village, you know, things were not going well. The hotel had finally really gotten on tough times and eventually went down for 10 years.
Yeah.
And so developers began to see Manchester as a place, a destination place, if they could upgrade these buildings and get stores in. And it created a huge real estate boom, as well as a building boom. I mean, anybody that could pick up a hammer got hired.
Right.
Anybody
what
that
are
could
we
pound
talking
a nail.
Here right now.
I got back from school in 64, and this started about 68,
yeah.
Somewhere
so
around
this. Timed the market well.
First, the second home industry started, and then gradually the big real estate, commercial real estate upgrade, and the outlet, so-called outlet store phenomena began.
That was all in the late 80s.
Well, and it all crept in.
Post-Eisenhower, we've got better roads now.
We got transportation.
You know, yeah, better
boomers,
access to the area.
People having families.
People are making money.
Right. Expanding out to the cities, pushing out.
And having second homes. That's a huge thing. I mean, Snowflake Lane up on the mountain all of a sudden burst forth, and little one-acre lots with small houses appeared. Then Stratton in the 60s started going, and first it was the mountain, and then they developed it into a huge second home industry around the mountain. And all this took a sequence of time, but it propelled our whole area into a very new era of the way we lived and who was here and what was going on.
And, you know, when you drive around, I think that first wave of second homes, particularly were in the style of the Tyrolean ski chalets.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Who brought that concept?
Fritz Dillmann.
Yes.
Fritz Dillmann.
You know Katie Dillmann? You know, must
yes,
know Katie.
Sure.
Her dad was an architect, and he pioneered the chalet.
Yeah.
Really. I mean, Fritz Dillmann designed homes all over that looked like Swiss chalets. He was, I think, a Swiss, perhaps. And he also did, Bennington was burning, and he designed a lot of the buildings on Main Street that the arsonist burned down in Bennington, and they looked like chalets.
And was this?
Yeah.
This was in the 60s, 50s, 60s, 70s.
Yep. Remember that there was that road going up the mountain, it's still there, where all those A-frames were built?
The old Snow Valley Road.
The old Snow Valley Road,
That was typical of...
That was the beginning of those affordable second home kind of things, and now they've all been expanded.
And then there was a thing called Tech Built, which was a prefab home, which got to be all of Murray Hill, original Murray Hill, was Tech Built, which are homes that are brought sectionally and put together, and it was a very popular model that was reasonably affordable to a lot of people. So until the big crisis came, when people were depending on renting their properties, and then we had a reversal in economics and nobody rented their houses, and the next thing they knew, they couldn't pay the mortgage, and the Rutland Savings Bank was taking over a lot of houses they'd lent money on, and eventually the Rutland Savings Bank
tanked. But not Factory Point.
No.
They had very conservative management at that time, and they wouldn't get into that sort of development.
Never really did.
A lot of banks did, and a lot of banks got handed back a lot of property around here, and everybody became bartenders that used to be real estate agents.
Yeah.
They were all behind bars slinging drinks because there was no work. As a matter of fact, I stopped selling real estate and decided to pitch into the insurance business about that time, because I could see that I wasn't going to make it in real estate. It had dried up. It had withered.
Right.
Totally.
Yep. Yeah.
So it was a very big changeover that occurred. And by after that is when we started the commercial development. It was after the big mortgage default era and the second home industry tanked.
Yep.
Then these developers... appeared on the scene and began to buy up local properties and redevelop them, and in some cases tear down and rebuild. And we have what we have downtown now today as a result of that.
Well, that's kind of when the culture of the town changed,
yes.
And that sense of community became something different. You know, what we talked about at first of the, you know, everybody knew everybody, and the, you know, where our parents hung out before we hung out, those kind of things. That's when it really kind of changed.
It was opportunity, but at the same time, you lost a certain way of life.
Yeah.
You know, a quality of life, if you want to call it that.
Yeah.
And for all the opportunity that it brought, young people had jobs, were making good money, were able to spend money in town, you know, buying cars and whatever. At the same time, that sense of community suffered, and people didn't know one another.
Absolutely.
As well. And you began to see a little bit of class differentiation based on economics.
Based on some people being more successful than
Correct.
Others.
And
as
you
a
had
of the
right.
opportunities
yeah.
that
you had
were.
You had 5 or 10 lawyers in town instead of 2. You had more doctors. You had more professional people. You even had some stockbrokers in town. So things really began to change, and it created different sections of the society. It fractured it a little bit, I would have to say.
Mm-hmm.
And so for all you gained, you also had to give up some things you might have been more used to.
Yeah, what was the population of this town back?
Well,
the
population
was 2,500.
No, that's what I was going to say.
2,500
people.
Yeah. You know, it hasn't changed much.
No, not really.
Yeah. What's changed is the influx of the second homeowner, which at certain times of the year balloons the population
sure.
to 4,000
right.
or 5,000. Particularly if you bring in Dorset as part of the community,
mm-hmm.
so to speak. Mm. But the actual residential population, that has been really rather stable. I think it's
yes,
around
it
3,000.
We've been saying that for years. It's 3,000 regulars kind of thing is really where we've been. Yeah.
But even, you know, even with your exposure to, you know, folks coming up every weekend and the second home folks, you always felt that you were part of this community, and you never had any desire to pack up and go try something else somewhere else in the
Those
world.
Those are the what-ifs.
What-ifs.
And I can't go there. I've had a good run in Manchester. I've been
sure.
able to raise my two sons here, and now my one son is raising his two daughters here. What could be better than that?
Full disclosure,
yep.
Craig is my insurance agent. And
okay.
He's oversold me on a lot of products. And
he has to deal with a guy named Bill Drunsic. So
Watch
believe
out.
Me,
That's
he's
right.
got to be tough.
That's right. Yeah. There's so many good things about, for people like us that have, allowed our roots to get really deep. You know, we talk about it often. Kathy and I are getting to a point where maybe it would be okay to spend some of the rest of our life living someplace else, but I really don't want to yet.
Yeah.
I don't, my kids are here and my siblings are all here. And if I get on the phone and say, we all need to get together, for whatever the reason
yeah.
is, whether it's fun or not, within a half an hour, we can all be in the same room. And, that isn't meaningful to some people, but
you have
if you
to
live
have been
this,
there.
Yeah, if you live this life like we've lived, we've both had opportunity to have careers in the town. We
sure.
grew up in that kind of thing. It gets really hard to think about living someplace else. I really don't want to for all of those kinds of reasons.
Sure.
There's a lot of great things about living here, culturally and friendships and business relationships and, you know, all of those things.
Athletic opportunities.
Yeah, all of those things make it really special.
Well, he's talking about athletic opportunities. You look at Burn Burton these days, they've got football again. Well, of course, they had football back.
There was football when I was there.
I played
there.
On a football team and never won a game.
Peter
Henry was the quarterback, and I was the center.
Yeah, well, I was
maybe in the center. I used
Are
to
you
get
calling yourself out now? Is this?
Yeah.
Oh, people would get under me with their and raise me up in the air under my chin and break my lips apart and bite my tongue. Oh my gosh!
It was fun, wasn't
it? It was something else. But the school was.
Burn Burton was nothing like it is now.
I had 56 people in my class.
Yeah,
I had 106 or. Yeah, something
like 106.
That. I did really. We were one of the bigger classes at that time, but yeah.
But now Manchester Elementary, that wasn't there.
When was that built? Third grade.
Okay, third grade. So you were in a new school.
First year I went to the school they tore down where the Zion parking lot is next to Gringo's.
Okay.
I had Miss Kelton for first grade.
Yep.
Second grade I went across the aisle and I had Miss Kelton for second grade. Same teacher. And
yep.
then moved over to the elementary school in third grade when they consolidated three schools into one.
Yeah.
And then, of course, they've added on to it a dozen times since then.
Yeah. I think that my brother Mike was one of the first Manchester kids to go all eight years at the new, what they called the new school. Yeah, so we all went there.
That was a big step.
Yeah, it was, yeah.
And Mr. Bigelow, who was the superintendent of schools, is a great story. They got all ready and set to build the school. They had done the bond issue and the whole thing, and then Mr. Bigelow suggested that they wait a couple of years until the price of steel went down. And of course, the price of steel never went down. It soared, and they said, no, we're committed and we're going to go ahead. But that was the conservative way of thinking in Manchester at the time. And so it was a huge, huge step to do that.
And that's, I guess that's kind of something that persists today, is two different ways of thinking about the direction for the community, and it sounds like it's always kind of been that way. You know, there's been these influx of new entrants into the market, new opportunities. I mean, you served on the select board, development board.
I served on the planning board.
Yes, absolutely.
And the zoning board. I never did serve on the selectmen's board, but I certainly was in the original planning, wrote the original zoning ordinance along with five other people.
Very active town government here.
And
to some degree, you do have a lot of responsibility sitting on those boards.
You do. You really do.
I'm sure your neighbors aren't, you know, scared to come up to you and say, hey, what are you thinking about?
There's no anonymity in Manchester.
Right, exactly.
You're at the movies and you're trying to have a nice time. And either somebody asks you how to get a broken windshield fixed and paid for by your insurance company, or they ask you why your kid got a D in something at the elementary school because you're on the school board.
Yeah, or
you know,
you're out to dinner and somebody steps up and asks what the mortgage rates are currently.
There's always been a festering.
Yeah.
It continues to fester that, for some reason, probably with good reason, Burn Burton changed from the official title from Burn Burton Seminary to Burn Burton Academy, and some people can't let that go.
Right.
It's, you know, the school is at the top of its game now. I have to disclose I'm on the board, but I'm so proud of that school. And Jim has been terribly involved.
I was on the board for about 10 years. And I was on the board at the time we changed the name. And I was working at the Equinox Square branch of Factory Point Bank at that time. And people came in every day because I was accessible
to scream
at me over the name change thing.
Do you think it was because using the word academy might have had an air of...
Possibly.
I think that...
A little bit of pretense or...
Well, I think that at the time, some of the thought process was that, to begin with, we were in the beginning stages of... getting information online, that kind of thing, and they were starting to post job opportunities online, and they felt
and
that
seminary is not your typical
right. They felt that probably a lot of the people who were seeing positions, if they were really thinking of the school in the true sense of the word, that it was really a seminary, and that's not what they were looking for. And also, some of it has there were some positive effects relative to fundraising and those types of
grants that would be eligible because of the seminary.
Yeah. So
at any rate,
it made some sense.
It did make sense, but it's one of those things that is not set completely well with some folks who went to Burn Burton, and at the same time, I would always just encourage any of those people to please come see the school and take a tour and see what's going on up there.
Yeah.
And you'll understand that this is an absolutely wonderful, wonderful opportunity
asset
for our kids.
Yep.
And what an asset to the community.
Absolutely.
Now.
And of course, now there's that new piece of property that
they bought, the Morgan property.
Are
next
you able
door
to divulge any plans?
They're really in the planning stage.
Okay.
But, you know, they need more room for athletic fields. They may need a real dorm at some point instead of several dorms, wooden dorms. They may need a central dorm.
Maybe they could have an economics department.
You know, there's a ton of things, but it's 22 acres, I think, and it practically doubled the size of the campus, which was really maxed out. Mm-hmm. And so it gives Burnburton an opportunity to plan for the future, for some growth in its needs, and they're going to do a very careful plan and slowly move into how they're going to use that property. But yeah, it's certainly expanded the possibilities greatly.
Now, Burnburton has always had some kind of exchange program going way back, as I recall. Is that correct?
Well, they do exchange. They had the Ormsby Hill. It was very big when I was in school.
Right, same here.
And, of course, that was a home that used to bring kids up just for the summer from New York City. And then it morphed sort of into a year-round where they put some of the kids in the elementary school and some at Burnburton, and then followed them into college and paid their college tuitions. And so that it was a very, very successful program, first run by a guy named Morgan Martin, Tex Martin, and his wife. And actually, their daughter Susan was a graduate of Burnburton. And then Ed Lotz took it over in the long run. And he ran it until it went down.
Psychology teacher.
And one of the Hardimans, who were the founders, ran it for 2 years also. And then, just like so many things, the financial requirements of maintaining the building and paying the tuitions in college and keeping it afloat just got to be too much. So they closed it down and sold the property. And they were operating a similar school type thing in California. And last I knew, that was still possibly in operation out in California. But the Manchester, obviously, is totally closed down. And it rounded the school out. It gave it some cultural diversity that it didn't have before. And I had a lot of good friends from Ormsby.
Yeah, I did too. And they rounded out our athletic program too. We had some very talented athletes that were Ormsby people, and it was great.
Sure.
Yeah.
Some people in the state claim that we fostered the program to make a better
That's right, yeah, just to...
Actually, the athletic program just happened.
It
wasn't a scholarship based on their athletic ability, believe me.
Right,
yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, I think today a lot of people look around and, you know, especially, I don't want to say old-timers, but...
It's all right. You can say that.
They might have questions about whether or not the town is better off today than it was, you know, three decades ago, mm-hmm. when things were a little bit simpler. Mm-hmm. You know, your property taxes were a lot lower. And everyone knew each other.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I think that question dogs everyone. And I'm just curious as to whether or not you think that we are better off as a town now than we were back when days were a little bit easier.
Well, I don't know. You know, those days when we were young, you know, I have to think about, I thought of it as a kid in those days, obviously, and now I think of it as an adult. And certainly when I was a kid, growing up in a town like we did, and everybody knew everybody, Mike's parents were friends with my parents, and one of my grandmothers and Mike's grandmother were next door neighbors for a pretty good period of time.
Yeah.
And so we connected that way. But then we did other things, like my dad was very active in the Rotary Club back then, and so was half the town of Manchester. And they were the club itself was really active, but we did things as Rotary kids to help the club. You know, and in the there was a pool here that the Rotary Club owned and maintained.
The center of the summer season.
It was the Manchester's summer.
Where was this located?
It was over
right
by MIMS.
Next to the school.
Yeah.
And the athletic field on the other side by the gym.
Yep. And the Rotary kids took care of the pool. I mean, we went there as younger kids, and it was a place where my mother would say, go to the pool, and we'd spend the afternoon over there. But then it got to the point where we had to clean the pool and open it up in the spring, close it in the fall, do all those kind of things. And they did other things like, there was a carnival there every year, and it was huge, wasn't it?
Part of August.
Yeah. So there was no wreck at the time?
No wreck.
Oh, gosh.
What was
no,
that?
That was the Manchester
Fairgrounds. Yeah, the harness track.
They had a harness track, and that was it.
But they'd have this carnival at the pool area. There was a water show and rides and all the kinds of stuff. But during the summer months, the Rotary Club would raffle off a car every year. So they would get a car from Henry Dooley down at the Ford garage, and they'd park it on Main Street every day, and the Rotary kids would sell the tickets. So Comar kids had to do that once or twice a week. We'd have to sit out on Main Street all afternoon and sell tickets to the car. And then they'd raffle the car off at the carnival.
And if you didn't meet your quota, what happened?
Oh, we met our quota, don't worry. Pete Comar kept coming out to make sure we were doing our job. But, but there was a lot of those kind of things that we all did as a community mm-hmm. back then. As an adult, I think there's lots of opportunity in Manchester. Yeah. There's some wonderful networking that goes on here. I think people support each other in business, and there's still the family things going on and the friendships, and you know, there's still some of that out there. And I think that those of us that have lived here forever are certainly welcoming of the new people that have become part of our community yeah. and serve on boards and you know, contribute in their own way, but there's the cultural things that have grown.
Sure. And it's a constant evolution.
Yeah, it is.
Sure,
and,
yeah.
And when I think I told you I interviewed when the big building boom was first starting for Vermont Public Television, and what I said to the fellow that came down to interview me was that, you know, we all have this ideal of cows and red barns and fields wide open.
Right.
Fields of plenty.
But yeah. that doesn't feed or employ people anymore, or didn't then. And as nice as that is, it's a bucolic image that we have in our minds, but it isn't reality, in my opinion. It wasn't. It was Chris Graff was the interviewer.
Okay.
And so things changed. And opportunities arose to become a building contractor, an electrical contractor, right. a plumber, a banker, an insurance agent,
yep.
a lawyer, an entrepreneur. Look at Bill Drunsic and what he does around. You know, he's entrepreneurial. He's always creating something. Well,
right.
those opportunities weren't really around back then. So, again, yeah. The thing that Jimmy grew up with, we all loved, and we can be nostalgic for, but we were also poor. I
right.
frankly have to tell you, we were, I think Jimmy was a lot less poor than we were. I mean, we had a kerosene stove and a pot burner in the living room, and I had to chug kerosene across, and whenever I'd spill kerosene on the rug, I'd get beaten.
But that was
really,
probably typical of the
it's
entire
the way
state.
Everybody
it
lived.
Was the way
yeah.
everyone lived. Right.
Yeah,
definitely.
You had a single bathroom, you had no central heat. You know, it was... But I didn't know.
Sure.
I was a kid. I was having a good time.
It was just a way of life.
Well, that post-war boom, though, that we had, that's where people started to...
Yeah, that's exactly right.
The economy started to fire on all cylinders.
Yep.
And afforded
all sorts of folks.
World
War II vets came back, and a whole
new opportunity.
New things started, and it built
and that
trickled
up to this area. But probably also because this area, for 150 years, was known as a destination for certain folks that came up during the summer,
right.
Equinox Springs, and
mm-hmm. you know, my grandfather Shaw was one of the main back in the early 1900s was one of the main promoters of Manchester, and he wrote a column for the New York Times called "Manchester in the Mountains," which is he coined that phrase.
Okay,
and his name was Walter Shaw, and he was an extremely civic-minded person. On every board in Manchester that I can find, his name appears. But you know, he was promoting Manchester, and at that time they were building the big homes on Taconic Road, and they were either for sale or for lease. And there were ads in the New York Times, come to Manchester, lease, play golf. And they were bringing people up who had substantial money from the cities, and they were bringing their families and, in some cases, their hired help and occupying these great big houses. And then Aquanic got built in 1899, and a lot of wealthy people moved in to take advantage of that and built permanent homes for the summer only,
mm-hmm.
obviously.
Right.
So
right.
we keep having it. First it was golf, then it was skiing, then it was second homes, then it was the outlet.
Yeah. Right.
What is it today? It's kind of consolidating all of these things into a community of opportunity, I see it as.
Creative anyway. Class.
Look at the library they're building now.
Right.
I mean, it's very controversial, frankly. And I would have maybe done things differently, but once the die is cast and they do something like that, I feel it's got to work. It's got to be good for the community,
right.
and I've got to get on board.
It's time to get behind it.
And get behind it. And the time for debate is over. Now it's the time to support. And we've had so many of those things. Riley Rink.
Sure.
Unbelievable.
The pool house.
Got the new pool house. And
roundabout.
Oh, the roundabout was constructed. We've got a new library going. We've got a wonderful big town office complex with a fire department. I mean, Manchester has never sat back. They've been fortunate to have wonderful people help. But at the same time, they keep looking forward and
to reinvent
growing and to reinvent themselves, which is what we're doing right now.
Sure,
that's right.
Did you happen to read the Rutland Herald yesterday?
I
didn't get to Texas
yesterday. Oh, well, there's a 90-unit Hampton Inn going.
Oh, I did.
Proposed.
Yes.
Yep.
In
I did
for
hear that.
Where
right.
we have
well,
the
group.
Former Chinese Panda restaurant.
Garden.
This
and,
is their
and
second attempt.
Things?
The same group that tried
same
to do
Same group that tried
yep.
to do this, but yep. it's totally, apparently, permittable under
yes.
the present zoning where they're going. So it sounds to me like we're going to have that. Now, I don't know. Maybe not. But it certainly sounds like they have every opportunity to mm-hmm. conform and build that facility.
And then yep. you've got Clark French's development, too.
And then
you've
got Clark French. I mean, the fence is up. I guess the place is going to come down soon. And I'm certainly hopeful that they do build a nice-looking place there that's going to be
sounds like it'll happen.
Something. It sounds yeah. to me like
yeah.
it'll
yeah.
happen.
And it does, to some extent, feel like while the economy is gaining traction, it almost feels like some elements, some sectors are still treading water a little bit, but
I think
there's
the
been
retail.
A lot of effort. Mm-hmm. Exactly. And yet, there's a lot of retail that's, you know, Hobbin's new building, which apparently is all
faith.
Leased out.
He seems to have faith that he will be able to put people in those stores. I would say he has very few vacancies in his stores. Now, the other stores were built at a time when Manchester was trying to stop development by and large by holding the size down. And what occurred, what some people maintain, and I think there's some validity, is that the space that they built doesn't fit the needs of any modern retailers.
Right, that's right.
It's neither fish nor fowl. It's 3,000 square feet, which doesn't do it for a large retailer, and it's too big for a small retailer.
Yes.
So here we have all these empty buildings. Now it looks like it'll be solved by them pulling some of those buildings down
yes.
in order to do this new
apparently
thing.
Pulling all those buildings down.
You know,
maybe not.
It's part of the evolutionary
sure.
change
yep.
that's
yep.
here. And are we losing a little bit more of our quality of life? Probably. Are we gaining some kind of momentum that's going to help the economy and mm-hmm. help people to live a good life? I'm pretty sure that answer would be yes.
I think you're right. Yeah.
And I would tend to agree with you. There would maybe be a counterpoint that's made by existing hotel establishment owners.
I think so.
That may say, well, now the addition of another 98 rooms
yeah.
and my occupancy rate has been X percent, what if this pushes me out of business and then I'm not paying taxes into the town anymore? There are those arguments that are made. This is historical
those arguments, will
arguments
always be
that are
and
made,
they are valid.
And
they are
valid.
I agree. We've had those conversations.
And yeah. there are always challenges.
Yeah.
But I guess we're fortunate to some extent to be a town that has people that take risks and that we have these kinds of challenges. Because mm-hmm. there are certainly
and you know, Jimmy touched on it. In the 50s and 60s, Manchester was the hub of the ski industry at night. Mm-hmm. And staying, you know, and
yeah,
lodging.
City again.
Yeah.
And lodging.
Yeah.
But it isn't anymore because they have built so many facilities and spaces on the mountain.
Right.
That's where the people want to be. They don't want to be way down here and have to drive 20 minutes to
right.
the area.
Right.
So a lot of those facilities that were built to accommodate those people, particularly in the winter, just don't have anybody around to fill them. It's just an unfortunate fact yeah. of life that we were eclipsed by Stratton.
Right.
That's right, yeah. And if any one of those respectable places of accommodation around here were to pull out some of their marketing material from the 60s and the pictures and stuff that they have, there's all the skiers' cars are out in front of them with the skis on the racks
right.
on the top. So
you never see that. Anymore.
Some
you
of those old shots of all the cars lined up
yeah.
in front of Bromley.
Right.
Oh, wonderful.
The
that's
road.
Right.
Yeah.
yeah.
Same
yeah.
thing.
Classic.
Yeah.
Classic.
Yeah.
Absolutely classic.
Yeah.
That was
yeah.
part of that. Sure.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. And it's just unfortunately, it's just things moving along and changing, and these things happen. And when they happen, you have to make the best out of them that you mm-hmm. possibly can and move on, yep. move forward. And you're going to make some mistakes along the way, but mm-hmm. you're going to have some successes also. We've had a lot of successes in Manchester.
We certainly have. And, of course, your former bank building, Factory Point.
Right.
There's something
Things are
going to happen
there.
Something's brewing. I certainly hope so.
Iconic landmark building, which has sat derelict for 3 years. What a shame.
Inexcusable.
And I think potentially could be the spark.
It's inexcusable for the present owners to have allowed that to happen.
I agree. I think a coat of paint would have been nice. But I think that, like as an example, last summer when Manchester did those couple of events on Main Street, I loved that. I thought it was great. And the second one, I was out there with your dad standing in the middle of the street, you know, just talking about Main Street and whatever. And we're having this conversation about what do you think we ought to do with this building here. And a lot of people chimed in and had some pretty interesting ideas.
Oh,
about
you know,
what
everyone's got an idea.
Yeah, but it all takes lots of
lots
resources.
Of money and an awful lot of groundwork.
Yeah, definitely, yeah.
Interesting, though, the building's in good structural shape.
Yeah, I bet it is.
It's very good structural shape. Yep. And
it's got some environmental
20,000-pound vault,
yeah.
which seems to me like a little bit of overkill for a bank that size, but maybe you can call
Well, they were protecting lots of good things.
Yeah,
yeah.
Bear bonds and...
People used to bring their silver there.
I like to think bars of bullion, but I don't know
if
that was...
People used to bring their silver in the winter. When they go away for the winter, they bring their silver in and store it in the vault. Paintings. Yep. I mean, all sorts of
things. Well, still there, I'm sure there's a vault in the basement that we...
I think there are seven vaults in that building, totally.
We used to call it bulk storage, and the summer people...
A lot of things were left.
...would come there. It was empty during the summer, but they'd come back in the fall and bring all their, like Mike says, their paintings and their silver chests and stuff, and buy the...
And just put it in there?
Oh, yeah, and I was kind of responsible for that for a period of time, so we had to catalog everything, and it got to the point where you couldn't go in there. It was so full of stuff. And everybody's valuables. Yeah, there was some interesting things in there. Yeah.
The gatekeeper.
You know, there's an institution that lasted over 100 years, well over 100 years, Factory Point Bank, and it had... I was chairman of the board when it was sold, and I won't look back. There's no way to look back. You do what you can to move forward, and that's exactly what that was all about. And some people still don't understand that or believe it, but Factory Point did what it could as long as it could, and when it started to show signs of weakness and that it could ultimately bring it down and hurt a lot of people, that's when you have to make decisions. Same with any business owner in town. When the business is no longer performing, you've got to either change it, modernize it, fix it, or do
you've
something
gotta
else.
You've got to be nimble.
You've got to move. You've got to move quickly. Yep. Otherwise, you get swallowed up.
They say Vermonters are nimble, hardy.
That's right.
You have to be. You have to be able to do everything.
Sure.
Yeah. That's why I'm repairing rot on my house right now.
And gardening.
A winter.
Keep it going.
When is that going to start?
The gardening is a chore. I'm way ahead on my gardening. But I've got one of my good friends, Tom Aloys, at my house as we speak, repairing the usual winter rot that finally emerges mm-hmm. in the spring.
The fun of an old house.
You know, snow piled up against a house for a winter does strange things.
Yeah.
It's a tough climate to live in.
Yeah. You know, we different subject, but we were talking about our roots in Manchester and Factory Point. And just recently, I attended a luncheon birthday party for Thelma Goodell.
Oh, my goodness.
Was one of my the first supervisor people, well, kind of one of the first supervisor folks that I worked for at the bank. She's 90 years old.
Oh, boy.
And she's still very active and busy and you know, she loves to socialize and that kind of thing. So there was a group of us that met with her for lunch. And it was Factory Point alumni sort of group of people. And Gail Jarvis was there. And she was Homer Ellis's secretary when I went to work there. And she lives in New York State now, but she joins the group.
A lot of people said she ran the bank.
She kind
of
did.
I remember as a kid, my mom working in the trust department.
Oh, yeah.
And my brother and I used to go and hide under her desk during work hours because she just couldn't
Yeah,
well,
that's
my mother worked there.
After
you know.
Care.
My
yeah.
mother, my mother went to work there. She was the first female officer of the bank, and I've got her silver tray. She got when she hit 25 years. They gave her a Sheffield silver tray, and they had it engraved wrong. It said "To Factory Point from Betty Powers."
You're local.
I know that. Sir. I know. Yeah.
So they had to take it off and redo it. So now it says "From Factory Point to Betty Powers." I just polished it.
Oh, that would have been those great mementos to keep, though, and frame. You
it's
know,
like the upside down airplane stamp that's worth millions of dollars.
I know. You know, I worked at the Equinox Square office for quite a while, and when that office closed, when they moved over to Richville or whatever, they, of course, moved out of there. And for a long time afterward, there was a Factory Point National Bank sign out on the canopy for the drive-up. It stayed there forever. And the guy, and the, Maurice Johnson and his guys are the we take care of the place. And he was over there one day, and I was walking by there, and I said, what happens to that sign up there? I said, it's been there for a long time. He goes, oh, they keep telling us we need to take that down. I got to take it. I'd probably take it to the dump. I said, well, don't do that. I said, I'm not really a collector of stuff necessarily, but if you're going to just take it to the dump, can I have it? And he said, oh, sure. So only in the next couple of days, it appeared beside my car over at the Bank of Bennington. So I now have it hanging inside my garage.
Good.
I've got my little
Manchester Historical Society.
They might like
that
to have.
Get
well,
rid
there
of
are
it.
Some other historical artifacts that are still
in the
building,
bank. I know that.
Oh,
top.
I bet there is.
Yeah.
I bet there is.
I've been in there, and there's some interesting artifacts.
I used to roller skate
upstairs. Some old books, when you go through some of the old transaction ledger books. My
those
goodness,
books were there when I went to work
You just get
there.
Lost in time going through that
You know,
stuff.
I used to roller skate upstairs in the bank where all those offices are now. That was all an open hall, and we would
it
go
was.
Roller skating on Saturdays. It was a stage. It was the Masonic Lodge.
Well, Masonic Lodge was on one side,
on
and
one
then
side
there was
the theater.
Yeah.
Initially, it was an opera hall or
opera. Yes, then
upstairs.
They called it the
what
opera.
What was her
hall.
Name? The
Estabrook.
Estabrook.
Yep.
House. Right.
If you go up to the top of the stairs and go left, that whole side of the upstairs was all wide open. We had Cub Scout banquets in there too.
We have wonderful pictures of the stage.
Yeah,
putting on minstrel shows.
Do
up
you?
There
yeah.
Where do I see? Where do I find these pictures?
Well, we've know. Got. We've got.
We've
some.
Got some that were my grandfather's.
Yeah, I do. I have some too, Mike.
And the Historical Society has tons of this stuff.
Well, I'm eager for them to take a place, their new home, and finally have a
it's
place
gonna be
to
wonderful.
Display everything. Because
definitely.
Every time I sit down and go through these books, I mean, even though my history in this town only goes back to the mid '70s, you know, I feel such an attachment to this town. Of course, I'm into local history. Just thinking back.
Go on the website. You have to be on Facebook, which I assume you are. Everybody is practically. Go on Manchester Historical Society and ask to be a member, and you will be overwhelmed with the things that you see on a daily basis. The wonderful pictures that are showing up.
Or when someone posts a picture and everyone starts commenting about, oh,
that's
I know
what
that
happens.
Person.
Oh, yeah, I love
that's
that.
Happens.
That's
stories,
so
the
much fun.
Going.
Yes,
there's
that's
one
so
picture
fun.
And it's got, I think, 49 or 53 comments on it.
Yeah,
isn't all
cool?
Interesting.
Yep.
Okay.
You know, I have this scrapbook that my grandmother, Comar, created during her life in the restaurant. And there's really no real rhyme or reason to it other than there's some very interesting stuff. And like one of the things, as an example, was back in the early '70s when the Factory Point renovated the building. Remember when we took it over?
Yep.
Purdy's had been in there and Heinels and
Justice DeVries was the architect.
Yes, right. And they totally renovated the building at that point. And the day that they hung the new sign over the door, the journal was there to take a picture of Homer up on a stepladder putting the sign up. So that article is in my grandmother's scrapbook.
Wonderful.
And then just coincidentally, when Berkshire took over the bank, the day that they were up on their stepladder taking
the
down the Factory Point sign and putting up the Berkshire sign, I drove by. I
picture?
Saw it going. I didn't take a picture. I had too much of a lump in my throat. I couldn't do that. Oh. But it was like.
We all did.
Yeah, it
you
was.
Know, maybe you ought to, in the new library, we've got all the space for exhibition. Of course, full disclosure, I'm on the board. We could do an exhibition of all this material.
Oh, yeah, that would be fun.
Well, we the Historical Society, I just went on the board of that, and Freddie Templeton's the new president, and they're reorganized, and it's really going to be I think going forward, it's been great in the past, but going forward, I think it's going to be a lot more
nice,
active.
Nice, great, and, great.
What will help that is the fact that it has permanent place to store and archive things and meet
and have speakers come in and talk.
Exactly, in the rooms, with the rooms right there.
It's going to be, I think, exciting.
I did that one time. They had an event at the Baptist Church, and they wanted to talk about the quality, I think. And
yeah, I did the Shaw family.
Yeah, I did that. It was fun.
An hour and a half thing I did for on the Shaw family, and their roots in the town. And
well, maybe I'll have to have each of you come back and just talk about your... Because, of course, we're out of time
here.
Once again, an hour goes by like 10 minutes, especially with a cordial gentleman like yourselves. But I want to thank you for coming on a Q&A Live.
Yeah, thank you for asking us.
It's been rewarding...
I've enjoyed it.
Yes,
me
I've
too.
Enjoyed it as well.
Me
now, I don't know whether I will enjoy watching it.
Yeah.
And you say there's
especially
no recourse.
With this Easter shirt on.
There's no recourse.
Our Easter show.
And we've got you looking. You've upgraded us terribly.
I know. I'll go there.
I'm going to look at my wardrobe when I get home.
Yeah. I'm going to watch it and go, oh, my God, who's that old man?
Oh, goodness. Well, we can always do some color correction.
Yeah, okay.
Anyway, thanks for coming to my show. Yeah. And thank you for watching one more hour of Q&A Live. And we'll see you next time. I'm Stephen Drunsic. Thank you.